I'm Atha Sharma, senior editor at Homecrux magazine. We've been covering tiny houses for a decade and have interviewed many eminent personalities across the globe, right from some tiny house manufacturers in Australia and New Zealand to tiny house manufacturers in Canada, US, and other parts of the world. And this time around, we're actually working on a tiny house ebook that will feature best tiny houses made in 2023-24 alongside interview of these people, the floor plan their companies are offering, and obviously you would be featuring in our ebook, because whenever the tiny house movement will go down in history, in the annals of history, if there would be one name who'd be etched in golden words, it'll be your Jay. How does it feel to be called a pioneer of tiny house movement or the father of tiny house movement?
I love it. It makes me feel important, like I've done something. Thank you for calling me that. Some people call me the grandfather of the movement, and I prefer godfather or pioneer. Makes me feel younger.
So when did you first dream of building a tiny house? How was the idea born?
Well, you know, it's hard to say. Well, nothing comes out of nothing. So there were certainly some inspirations. I had seen a book by a guy named Lester Walker. Les Walker wrote the book Tiny Houses back way back. And I was inspired by all these little structures that were in there. And I thought, you know, well, I looked up tiny houses in some other places. And it turns out laws in America forbid tiny houses. So when I learned that they were illegal, I just had to do it and show that, in fact, tiny houses safe and efficient and really should be the standard for housing in general. Like, how low can we go in terms of size and efficiency?
And what did you do before opting this as a career? What were the early reactions of your family and society when you started living in a tiny house you made for yourself?
Well, at that time, I was working an adjunct professor position at the University of Iowa's art department, teaching drawing. And I was also working in a grocery store in the produce department. And the flexibility of those things allowed me to, it gave me a lot of time to design and build a house on the side. I had been living in an Airstream of just 14 feet long for 2 years prior to building my first house. And that was sort of my experiment. Like, what do I need? What do I not need? I decided I needed far more insulation, at least in Iowa, which is where I was at the time.
What was the early reaction of the people and the society that they showed to you?
I heard more than one person say, I have got to see this, as I told friends that I was building this thing. And it was invariably positive from the beginning. People were very excited by the little house I built, and they loved the idea. And, you know, I got it into a magazine. Natural Home Magazine was doing a contest, and I actually won that contest for Most Innovative House of the Year. And they posted my philosophy on tiny houses, just about the efficiency and whatnot. And then I was in, because from then on out, it really took off exponentially. Every year it's become more and more popular.
Since you're an authority on tiny houses, I have to ask you this question, because there's a lot of obscurity about what a tiny house on wheels truly is. So what, according to you, is the true definition of a tiny house on wheels? Has it got something to do with the measurement or what it is?
Well, I've always tried to stick with the definition I had from the beginning, which was that any house in which all the space is used and nothing is wasted is a tiny house. So that could be any house. Now, a tiny house on wheels would have to meet the road requirements, you know, unless you really want to get into some weird bureaucracy of moving bridges and power lines. So that would be probably 400 square feet or less in the United States. And definitely no taller than bridges are.
Yeah. Did you envision that tiny house movement would become the next big thing in the architectural landscape? And what was your inspiration behind the tiny house movement and the decision to live in a tiny home?
Well, I didn't realize it would take off as big as it did. That would have been hard to imagine. I figured there was a need for it because I was so into the idea and my friends were so into the idea that there had to be other people who would really like this idea. But the inspiration, it was pretty much like, why wouldn't I build a tiny house? You know, just I didn't have a lot of money, so I couldn't afford, it didn't seem I could afford a standard mortgage. And I wanted to do things my way, have my house my way. So I basically had to build it myself or accept a tract home style house. So it was largely because of the artistry. I just wanted to make a house that was cool. And, you know, it was the efficiency and the economy as well.
And what started as a minimalist revolution is now a social media staple. Was this the future you envisioned for tiny homes?
I barely knew what social media was when I built my house. The internet was new to me at that time. And so I really didn't know how it was going to take off and how the internet could really spread this sort of thing so fast. I did think it would become popular, but, you know, it's hard to imagine it becoming huge. I'm glad it has.
And there has been a momentous change in tiny house movement over years. Both people and manufacturers are looking to buy / sell homes that are actually park models. Has this got something to do with generational change, or people nowadays are finding it difficult to what they call living in a cramped house?
Yeah, I think that what's maybe going on is a lot of people are going for the biggest of tiny houses, which would be like a park model, you know, a 400 square foot RV. That's essentially like a house on wheels. And I think it's not so much about the tiny thing as the economic thing. The price and the permitting and all is much easier when you get into a park model RV. And in the United States, bureaucracy is thick. So a lot of us like to get around whatever laws we can through whatever loopholes exist.
And what are you up to these days? Are you still building, designing homes? And what are the key design principles you consider when creating tiny homes, and how to ensure these factors contribute to a more sustainable living?
Yeah, well, to me, the beauty is very, very important. So I'm always sticking with what might be called sacred geometry, although really there is only one geometry. Sacred geometry is just when you assign meaning to each number and form. So I really stick with that, because I figure if you're going to go with less quantity, you might as well go with a lot of quality. That isn't universal throughout the tiny home industry. There are a lot of great houses out there, but there are also a lot of people just cranking out houses because they realize there is a demand. And I think I may be missing some other question that was in there, but...
What are you up to these days? Are you still building tiny homes?
I am, although mostly what I do is sit around designing tiny homes. I'm trying to design houses now that meet the US codes. And then I'm designing houses that are very similar to those houses, but actually are safer and more efficient because they don't meet the code. And so people can buy either one. And so now I have a large stockpile of tiny house designs that I haven't even put out there yet. I've got to get that out. It feels very feels strange having this material and not putting it out there.
Since the keyword here is the zoning regulations and building codes, there's still a lot of obscurity about both. How do you address these challenges when advocating tiny house living?
Well, oh, I'm sorry, there's an alarm going off over here. I'll turn that off. Actually, that's part of my passion recently. All last year, I spent a year writing an essay that only turned out to be 8 pages long in the end by the time I edited it down. But it was about codes and zoning and about how in the U.S., a lot of the provisions of our codes are not legal. They aren't constitutional. In other words, there are preemptive laws that make them invalid. So the code is actually a lot more sensible than it looks. I mean, the fact is it's very confusing in its verbiage, so it doesn't describe what it's really trying to do very well, and it confuses even the building inspectors. When you really look at all the fine print, it says do whatever you want as long as it's as safe and efficient as what this code prescribes. So you can get away with almost anything, and smaller houses are stronger inherently, all things being equal. So they're great for earthquakes and, you can roll them away if there's a fire or a hurricane coming. So they are very, very practical in terms of safety.
Can you discuss the economic aspect of living in a tiny house, including construction cost, maintenance, and long-term savings?
Yeah, well, I chose to live in tiny houses at the right time because I now live in California, Northern California, where the economy here is just crazy. It's like I was just talking about this 20 minutes ago with the bus driver. And it's very, very expensive to eat, live, everything here. So I have chosen to, I pared down my life to the smallest tiny house I've designed and built yet, which is only a ridiculously small 8 by 7 feet. Now that doesn't include a bedroom. I mean, it is a bedroom. It's basically a bed with a roof over it and a desk and some storage, but the bathroom and kitchen are outside. So it is amazing how one can get by with so little. You know, I built this whole thing for about $5,000. And live so well.
Do you have any memorable stories or experience from your own tiny house living journey that have shaped your view or alternative housing?
Oh man, I'm sure I do. Let me see if any come to mind. Could you repeat the question? I'm sorry.
Do you have any memorable stories or experience from your own tiny house journey that have shaped your view on tiny house living?
Oh, yeah. Well, everything's shaping my view of tiny house living all the time. Like, I'm always getting new information and a lot of the anecdotes I hear from other people, other people's stories are very informative. I've always said from the beginning that if you're going to be traveling around the country a lot or the world a lot with a tiny house in tow, just go for an RV because it's more aerodynamic. It's built for traveling around a lot. And I have learned that that is, in fact, true. Not only from other people's stories, but from having hauled houses around myself. As you get close to the eastern United States with a tiny house in tow, the bridges get shorter and shorter. So I whacked off the metal ridge cap on the top of my first tiny house driving out there once. I've learned that insulation is very important. I knew that from the beginning, but vapor retarders, just trying to keep the, you know, mold is a big no-no. So when you're doing a tiny house, you can actually watch out for all that stuff because there's so much less to look out for. I hope that answers your question.
Yes, it does. It does. In 2002, you founded the Tumbleweed Tiny House Company with one of your partner, who I assume is Steve Weissman. And nearly a decade later, when tiny house movement was at its peak, you decided to leave the company. What was the reason?
Well, I'd started Tumbleweed back in Iowa when I finished building my first house. I pretty much launched pictures of my house and the story of my house and the business all at one time, along with a book I'd written on the subject. And then a few years later, maybe it was 5 years later, I hooked up with Steve Weissman because he seemed to be a business-minded person. I am definitely not. And so I was looking for somebody to take care of that end of things. Things went south with us. We had different views of what should be going on in the company and the messaging and whatnot. So I split. I took off, went my own way, and started designing houses elsewhere.
And after your departure from Tumbleweed, you founded Four Lights Tiny House Company. What's the current status of the company?
Yeah, you've done your homework. Four Lights was actually it still exists in some sort of as some ghost ship. I don't actually man that business anymore. Don't look at the website. I doubt the website's out there unless you go to the Wayback Machine.
I was trying to find it. I didn't find it.
Okay, then yeah, it's gone because I wasn't manning it in the end. I just it was an attempt to make a better tiny house company. Unfortunately, what happened with that is that Tumbleweed came after us with over 100 lawsuits within a single month, you know, fake lawsuits about things that were nonsensical just to try and shut us down. And in fact, the legal costs did shut us down. And so I actually exited the more visible side of the tiny house world at that point and the business side and just started focusing on the codes, the zoning, and the design. I am gearing up now to open a new business, keep it simple, just sell houses and and the 3,000 books I still have sitting around.
And when can we expect you to start your own company, which you are actually talking of? How long can it take?
It's like the voice of God is speaking to me now. Like, when are you going to do it, Jay? Because this is what do I... Yes, apparently within the next month or so. Of course, I said that last month. But it does seem like it's virtually ready to go now. So I'm very eager to see all the presentation drawings and whatnot done and up, because that's the part now I'm working on, like making it all look pretty.
So you're going to offer design, you're going to offer floor plans, or you're also going to build homes?
Yeah, I think my focus in this case will probably be working with a manufacturer who can produce the houses while I design the houses and sell my book, because there is such a demand and building them myself is just so much work and it gets a bit harried. So my plan, you know, ideally I would become a nonprofit and just work with cities and counties across the US and the world perhaps to provide housing that they're all looking for now. Because in the US, cities and counties that were using the zoning to preclude affordable, efficient housing are now realizing they've got to fix the problem they created, and tiny houses are the answer to that problem.
Jay, what advice would you give to an individual interested in embracing a tiny house lifestyle, both in terms of design consideration and practical aspects?
Oh yeah, that's a good question. Well, the first step would be discerning how much you need. That's the most difficult part, I think. It took me like a year just to figure out what I needed and what I didn't need of the stuff I had. Helps to like maybe go on a little backpacking trip. Whatever you can fit in your backpack, you'll probably need. But if you don't need it, you're going to find out soon, because it's just going to be an extra weight in your bag. And then expand that a bit. Just take, you know, you might want to also have your laptop and some other things. So discerning what one needs and doesn't need is not only practical, but it's very, it's kind of metaphysical, because it really helps one to understand who one is. So that would be the first step. And from there, it's just a, you know, design the heck out of it, I'd say, because if it's designed well, it'll be great. Some people can go ahead and start building without a design and it works for them. I don't understand it, but some people can do that.
I actually like this definition of you. A tiny house is indeed a backpack in itself. All you need is a little bedroom, a small washroom, a bathroom, a kitchen, and that is done. And it would come at a very small measurement. But people nowadays, I don't know, has it got something to do with a generational change? They've been asking for more. They've been asking for a spacious bathroom. They've been wanting a spacious bedroom. They want, many, many guys want two lofts. They also want a main floor bedroom. So What's happening in the tiny house industry?
Well, I think that's been going on for a long time. I think that there's, you know, it kind of started with the TV shows where it was glorifying the shows were glorifying like the very innovative tiny house with the pool table and the jacuzzi. And they kind of had to use that angle in order to keep it interesting every episode. So everything was different each time. I think that caught on as an idea. What I was proposing in my book from the beginning, and what a lot of people are still into, is just paring it down to the essence of life, you know, and then outsourcing the rest of it. Just go to the swimming pool, the public swimming pool, or you know, not everyone needs a full library in their house. But I do think that that's just a natural, it seems to be a natural, I don't know, it might be an American thing more than anything else, but we Americans do tend to like our stuff, a lot of stuff. So that could explain part of it too.
How do you see the intersection of technology and tiny houses living, evolving in the future? And what innovation do you find the most promising?
Oh, well, technology has paralleled, the growth of technology has paralleled tiny houses perfectly. It's like when the tiny house movement started in around 2000, everything started getting smaller. You know, when I first built my first house, I didn't know how I was going to have a phone, because I didn't want to put phone lines all the way up across the hayfield I was living in. And then the cell phone thing I discovered, it's like it was the size of a shoebox, but it took care of that problem. You know, I had a TV in my first tiny house. Now I can just have a laptop, and the laptop contains the TV, the communications, the, you know, Photoshop the everything. So I think if I just had a little roof over my laptop here, I think I might be set to go.
All right. So I've asked this question before, but to conclude things, I'd again like to ask you, can you discuss any ongoing or future projects you're excited about that continues to promote sustainable and minimalist living?
Well, I think tiny house villages are, well, they're very exciting to me. I've been talking about them since day one, and I've never actually built and designed one my way. And yet I've advised on a couple of tiny house villages that turned out very well. They were just too expensive. They were burdened by the codes and zoning. At this point, I know the codes and zoning so well, I think I could build a village of similar quality and quantity for like half the amount that we built the nice tiny house village just over in Santa Rosa for. So I think the tiny house village thing is a big part of what's coming our way. You know, and tiny houses don't have to be these individual houses on wheels necessarily. I mean, apartments are the most efficient way to house people because then you get your shared walls and whatnot. And that has been a part of the tiny house movement as well. It's like apartment therapy is the tiny house. I think it's still around. It's the tiny house apartment, apartments of tiny house world website. And there, you know, the sky's the limit, because now that we're learning our limits in terms of size, we can design far more efficiently. I would imagine perhaps in India, and I know elsewhere, you guys would know more about what can be done in terms of small, efficient, simple living, because perhaps you haven't gone the full way of, haven't gotten suckered into the McMansion to the point where as a universal thing and all you could find is these big houses and on giant streets, you know?
It's pretty different here in India. The tiny house movement has still not arrived. I think it has got a lot to do with the roads and the government rules and regulations. So it's still not popular over here, but I assume it could be the next big thing in India as well. And Jay, it has been an incredible pleasure to have you with Homecrux today and have my questions answered. And as soon as the interview goes live on Homecrux, and as I pen it down for the ebook, I'd send a copy to you.
Thank you so much. It's great talking to you.
It's wonderful talking to you, Jay. My pleasure. Thank you very much. Have a great day ahead.
You too. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.